the beautiful Sydney Harbour Bridge, one of the world's great landmarks, just 30 kilometres east of the start of the inaugural Repco Mountain Rally for Classic Cars. Parramatta Park, historic site of Australia's first government house on a crisp winter's morning. The 93 competitors anxiously preparing for the start. Many months of planning and preparation by competitors and organisers about to pay off.
Just have to make it work.
We won't get lost.
Right.
Okay. Beautiful day.
Ready to go.
We're going to have a terrific time.
The West brothers from Wagga Wagga.
Yes, we're going to win. You got it? On record?
We're going to win the vintage class. No. We will do it on the highway.
And we're going to enjoy it.
Now, no air condition.
Yeah, it is. Fully air conditioned.
I think we're here to supply the comic relief.
Definitely comic relief.
Being the oldest and the smallest engine capacity, we don't have any pressure on us because everyone expects us to come last.
Very excited.
Another 5 minutes and we're on our way. Pretty nervous about the navigational part, but I think we can get by without any problems. If we're still talking to each other by the end of the week, it'll probably be a miracle. But if he complains too much, he's taking over the navigation and I'll do the driving.
No, I'll just be told, drive, he'll do the direction. We'll be right.
I'm so nervous I can't cope.
But we're very happy. We're very, very happy. Yes. This has been a beautifully organised rally so far and we're looking forward to it enormously.
Yes.
And we hope to win.
Yes.
4, 3, 2, 1, 3. First car away, a 1934 MGPA, Frank Harwood and Tony Bartlett.
Peter Thompson Grand Prix entry, Sunbeam Tiger, 1964. We're not sure how we're going to go, but we're going to be in it for fun.
Ah, good morning, Mr. Mayor.
How are you today?
Very well.
Good.
How are you this morning?
Oh, not too badly.
Good. Yeah. It's nice of you to turn up and flag us off.
Even though he was late.
Any secrets?
No secrets.
Who looks the power behind you?
No, the wife's driving it off. I'm just working behind the wheel.
Doug and Robin Partington in their Ferrari Dino.
Great navigators and great drivers.
The Repco Mountain Rally, conceived and organised by the Jaguar Drivers Club, attracted entries from all over Australia and included an entry from Japan.
Really excited. Well, I think I do my best. Yeah.
No secret at this stage, we can't divulge too much.
Really start now, it's good.
gates? Where's the boom gates? Set the speedometer at the boom gates, it says.
Oh, shit.
Well, I think we'll go straight up here. Yeah. Mate.
As we ride with John Robinson and Graham Mooney in their rare Mark V drophead Jaguar, they and many competitors had little or no idea what lay ahead, as the first stage was a very simple navigational task.
You're not going fast enough.
Ripco Mountain Rally was to take its competitors 1,500 kilometres through some of the most picturesque and typically beautiful Australian countryside. The organisers set what would prove to be a demanding and at times frustrating task for drivers and particularly navigators. If this wasn't enough, two fabulous although exhausting days of competition, including motorcana, skid pan and regularity events. The highlight of this competition was the chance to compete at the famous Mount Panorama circuit at Bathurst on day three. As is always the case with motor car enthusiasts, help comes in many forms. Past and current presidents of the MG Car Club looking after a control point. Many forms of navigational aids were used to good effect. The first stop for the day. The old wartime flying boat base at Rathmines on the shores of beautiful Lake Macquarie. Now, not only was this the lunch break, but the first test on the tricky motorcana course at the lakeside. Richard Johnson, former national motorcana champion, putting his MGB GT through its paces. Paul Samuels in his beautiful AC Ace. Graham Towers in his superb 1969 Lancia Fulvia. And our furthest travelled entrance all the way from Tokyo. beautiful Mercedes-Benz 190 of Robert Keane. Garth Taylor from Shell in his 3.8 Jaguar. Of course, the beautiful Mark V drophead of John Robinson. Jeff Leake, a restorer of Jaguars, driving his superb Austin Healey. Now the beautiful SS Jaguar of running director Doug Henderson, capably driven by Wheels Magazine's Michael Starr. John Macy and Keith Chapman in their magnificent 356B Porsche. It's a 1600 and one of only two Porsches in the rally. Bradley O'Connor originally entered in an E-Type V12 Jaguar, sadly suffered a minor mechanical malady. The organisers generously allowed a change of car, hence his 1968 Pontiac Firebird. Jocelyn Vettoretti and Graham Ward in their beautiful Lancia Beta Spider Zagato.
Trying to get ourselves organised before we start and get lost.
Navigation didn't come naturally for all competitors, despite an intensive five-minute navigation school the night before the start, where many people heard the word Roma for the first time, or is Roma the location of the Colosseum? Our resident rally chiropractor Malcolm Henningham and Robin moonlighting as control officials. One of the tasks of the navigator was to answer some very unusual questions, such as the age of this church.
Thank you.
Just one more control to the end of the first demanding day. Frank Vandervoorn's beautiful Healey Sebring replica. At the end of day one, only one of the 93 entrants failed to finish. Mike Gunnell's beautiful MGA had blown a head gasket at the Motokana circuit some hours earlier. Jubilation for many navigators who found it a tough task to guide their drivers to this very welcome overnight stop at Singleton in the magnificent Hunter Valley, the heart of the New South Wales wine-growing district. Some cars will require minor servicing to ready them for day two. At the end of day one, and jubilant Ian Hancock and Stephen McCullough were leading the rally in their beautiful Austin Healey 104 with a loss of only 35 minutes. In second place, car number 18, the Mini Cooper of Peter Edwards and Jack Brownlow, down only 44 minutes. And in third place, car number 73, the beautiful Saab of Wanda Tucker and Earl Carter with a loss of 45 minutes. A superb day greeted competitors and spectators as they gathered to tackle the second day, many of them hoping the navigation would be a bit easier than the final stages of the previous day. Start of day two, Danny Castro and his magnificent MGTC first car away. The Jones boys driving their 1929 Chrysler Le Mans replica. David and Wendy Wheatley in their beautifully restored Cooper S. Alan Shepherd and Brian Avery, all the way from Perth, some 10,000 kilometres to compete in the Repco Mountain Rally. Bob Williams and Ian McCauley enjoying the run in their Mark IV Jaguar. Arrived for the second day, the lunch stop at Bilpin in the beautiful Blue Mountains. Michael St. John Cox greeting competitors at the lunch stop of the second day. Kenny Wagemaker with Bob Slender in their TR3A had a difficult morning, missing a passage control, losing several minutes. Frank Vandervoorn almost clean-sheeted the morning and was up with the leaders. and the Jones boys not long returned from running their 1929 Chrysler in the famous Mille Miglia. Bar Smith enjoying their immaculate Healey 3000.
Hey, 39.
There you go.
Got the cards for these guys over here. I'll give it to you. Cards 54. Right.
And a surprise, Mike Gunnell, out in the first day, having travelled back to Sydney to rebuild his engine after blowing the head gasket, has re-entered the rally. What a way to spend the day. MGA, Saab and a 190 SL Mercedes head through some typical Australian countryside, followed closely by two Jaguars. Brown, having a great time in his Aston Martin with minimal points loss, is moving very close to the top runners list. Number 18, the Cooper S, running second at the end of the first day. And many drivers and navigators were now realising that the Repco Mountain Rally for Classic Cars was not a country gentleman's run, but a full-on rally with real navigational tasks. Clerk of the course, Geoffrey Bott, intended that all competitors should complete their runs before dark. We were all beginning to realise what it was all about. Many tall tales of the epic run of day two would be swapped this evening. All competitors finished day two. Jeff Leake and his beautiful Austin Healey was to suffer some serious damage, Could the car be rebuilt in time for the big day? We are all waiting for a great day, a full day at the fabulous Mount Panorama Circuit. At the end of day two, still leading in their Austin Healey 100 for number 94, Ian Hancock and Steve McCullough. In second place, still the Cooper S of Peter Edwards and Jack Brownlow, their car number 18. And in third place, a change on the leaderboard, car number 93, the Pontiac Firebird of Bradley O'Connor and Jeff Swavely. The missing of a passage control by Wanda Tucker and Earl Carter in their 67 Saab saw them off the leaderboard. At the top of Mount Panorama, it's dismal, mist, fog, rain, you name it. It looks like our big chance to test ourselves and our machines to the famous Mount Panorama circuit might be off. Now the hill climb uses the S's, that through forest elbow, in reverse to the major touring car events. Bathurst, as a rural community, has not had rain for 7 months. And believe it or not, the locals have hailed us as rainmakers. Jeff Leake was able to rebuild his beautiful Austin Healey in time for Bathurst. Jeff had worked all night with the NRMA and a friendly local garage to repair a whole sump, a damaged petrol tank and rear suspension. Bill Carter and Harold Duddington had also travelled from Perth to compete in the Repco Rally. Their wives Wendy and Margaret were pressed into rally duties. Bill Keegram with his E-Type a little out of shape on the S's. As the weather deteriorated, officials elected to make the hill climb a regularity event. Moving down the mountain to the famous start-finish area of Mount Panorama, we've set up the sprint course. This poor old Sunbeam Tiger was the victim of over exuberance on the S's.
It runs. It's drivable, yeah.
It hasn't hit the radiator.
No, it hasn't hit the radiator. The worst bit is the nose of the chassis. The chassis is bent around. You can't, that's why I couldn't jack it up, get the wheel off. To knock the wheel, the guard off the wheel. All right. We pulled it off as much as we could, and we've managed to roll down the hill.
We're going to have a look at it,
eh? Yeah, good idea. The
kangaroo jump at it. Oh, my, 15.
All right.
And the second is that it will be served now in the media centre, where there are chairs and tables, which is right behind the ARBC office.
Ferrari sounding like only a Ferrari should.
35 for a second run, 43 for a second run. And that's on number six, if they can see me.
At the end of day three, there were no changes in the major positions, but after an exciting day's competition on Mount Panorama, Colin Wilson-Brown in his Aston Martin DB6 and Doug Partington in the Ferrari Dino were moving up the leaderboard, with Rod Imey in the Alfa Romeo in hot pursuit. Our rally officials heading out to their controls on a beautiful winter's morning as the field heads to Canberra, Australia's political capital, for day four of the inaugural Repco Mountain Rally. Hancock's beautiful Austin Healey still leading the event. John Macy in his 1961 356V Porsche running seventh at the moment. Samuels and Stephen Knox in Paul's AC Ace finding the navigation challenging. Thank you. close call for rally photographer Rod Imey. Our Japanese competitors on track at last and having a great time. Ed Holly in his MGA coupe heading into the sunset toward the finish. Control coordinator Geoffrey Rudlin heading for Canberra. Canberra turned up a mixed weather bag, pitch black one minute, bright the next, with intense thunderstorms which didn't augur well for day five at the Canberra Motor Sports Centre. And here the cars finishing day four at the old Parliament House.
Yeah, we went well yesterday in the competitive events at Mount Panorama, but how we actually went today, we were doing fine up until we reached Canberra, then we sort of got lost.
What's such a thrill in it for you?
Oh, just to be out with a whole lot of classic cars and the terrific camaraderie between all the people. It's been a lot of fun.
Have you enjoyed so far?
Oh, it's been great. It's been some hard sections, a lot of tricky questions, but it's a challenge and it's been very enjoyable.
So what's it like though, being a lady amongst sort of the men around here?
It doesn't really make any difference. I mean, you're here to drive a car and you get treated the same as anybody else. But it's a lot of fun. And anybody who is interested in doing something like this, really, this type of rally is excellent because you're not going into the outback. It's all fairly controlled. The roads are good to drive on and you can really enjoy yourselves.
Have you been enjoying it so far?
Oh, it's been a fun rally. Really good. The weather's been pretty good to us too. And the country folk, they've been very kind and helpful. Yeah.
How's your car been holding up?
The car's going well. We're driving a 1968 Firebird 400 made in America, Pontiac car. It's going well. We're running on time. We haven't had any problems whatsoever. The power's had to pull us out of a few problems. We're running late on time and things like that. But other than that, we're running quite well.
What's the big kick out of this for you?
Oh, it's just an event which you don't get to do very often. We've got a lot of great cars which never come out of the garage. And so on this kind of event, you can get out and do a few events with them, have hill climbs, and generally have a lot of fun with it.
This was our hill climb event at Bathurst yesterday. I did the first run up the hill, and everything went perfectly. Second run up the hill, did the same thing because it was supposed to have been a regularity run, and there was a lot of oil dropped on the track, and as I tramped it out of the little straight from the start line, it just spun around on me and I hit the wall. Very, very slow collision, but enough to do as much damage as there is here. And we went to a local garage and they jacked it out with some quarter powers, and an hour later we're back in the rally. We went back out to Bathurst and Mel took over then. He didn't want to see me driving again because it's his car, you see. And he did the slalom course and made a reasonable time. So we did all the events, and except we didn't qualify for the regularity twice up the hill. But this is the result.
I did cry, and I'm still crying, really. But I restore these cars, and we'll get it back on the road, no problem.
Not a lot of changes taken place in the leaderboard of day four, although some new players in the results. Ian Hancock in the Healey 104 still leading the rally. Brad O'Connor in the Firebird, a very credible second. Rod Imey and his Alpha Spider still in third place. Colin Wilson-Brown and the Aston Martin. John Macy and Keith Chapman, new players in the Porsche 356B. And Doug and Robin Partington in the Ferrari Dino.
Day five and the rally's moved to Fairbairn Park, the former police driver training centre just outside of Canberra. Unfortunately, we've brought the Bathurst weather with us. It's cold, overcast and drizzly. There'll be four major events today. The hill climb, which will be a bit of a trial for this old girl, 2.5 litres and 2 tonnes. There'll be a skid pan with plenty of slipping and sliding, I should imagine.
I wouldn't mind.
The Gymkhana event in the car park will doubtless mark the death of several witches' hats. For the road regularity event, competitors do one lap at their own pace, then go out for a second lap and attempt to match that time. Ian Cummins of Sydney, you've been around the historic racing scene for quite a while, particularly with Jaguars.
Yes, I suppose I've got a slight leaning towards Jaguars. I think I've had 9 XK120s and various SS100s and C-type, D-type and E-types. Yeah, I've got it pretty bad as far as Jaguars are concerned.
And historic rallying, you've done a bit of it in your day. I mean, how's the Repco Mountain Rally shaping up?
It's great. It's the navigation side of it is a lot harder than, you know, say, the Lucas Grand Prix Rally. But we're having a lot of fun, and you know, the competitive side of it is great. And if it's weather stays fine today, we'll have a lot more fun.
We're now on day five. How are you guys running?
Haven't seen the results for the last couple of days, our placings, but you know, we've been into a few controls the wrong way and the odd thing like that, but we're still smiling.
I'm sure you're not alone in that though.
No, the main thing is to keep talking to your navigator. Yeah, she's threatened to go back to Tasmania a couple of times, but she's still here.
As long as you're having fun. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, mate.
John Thompson of Shell, you've been around the motor racing scene for quite a while. How's the Repco Mountain Rally shaping up?
Oh, it's fantastic. Without question, it's just fantastic. It's a winner.
On day five, the field was split into four groups. One for the hill climb, the second group to the regularity section, while the third and fourth groups were in the motor, Kana and skid pans. Also a chance for the navigators to relax and even have a drive. Who knows, perhaps a Fangio or a Moss may emerge. Hot time in the old Volvo. Service crew from the National Roads and Motorists Association always there when the competitors needed a hand. Earl Carter looking like a winner in his 1967 Saab.
It gets along that thing, doesn't it?
Ferrari a little locked up at the bottom of the hill. John Macy having a great day in the 356B Porsche and moving up the leaderboard. Graham Towers into the tyres, showing us how not to take the corner in a Lancia. Peter Edwards had been running second until Cara. Sadly, a broken CV joint cost them an hour and 38 minutes, effectively ending their chances of finishing in the top order. Don Parker, our oldest entrant at 80 years of age, drove his E-Type all the way from Brisbane. Frank van der Voorn, always spectacular in his Healey Sebring replica. The eventual winner of the day, Jim Katz in his beautiful Porsche Carrera. After day five, Tony Galletly in his latest from Brisbane had proved consistent in both days' competition and will take out the top sporting prize of the rally. John Macy in the Porsche 356B had also had a consistent day. Of the first six cars, now only 7 minutes separate them, and an exciting finish looks certain.
Friday, the final day of the rally. The competitors left Old Parliament House this morning at 8:30. 25 cars, the front runners taking off, and then the remainder leaving in groups. And we know, but they don't know yet, that they are bound for Marulan, and later they'll be travelling along the coast to Nowra. And even we're not sure about that.
Ian Hancock, desperate to make up time after missing a passage control earlier. Running their first rally and having a great time, David and Wendy Wheatley started this morning in the top 20 at Canberra. Final destination for the 91 finishers of the Repco Mountain Rally, beautiful Flagstaff Lighthouse at Wollongong on the south coast of New South Wales. Is it too early to think about next year, I wonder, or are we just happy to finish? Mixed thoughts from the crews of the 91 finishers as they check in for the last time.
How did the course go?
Excellent, excellent course. A lot of back roads and a lot of back tire roads, but excellent.
Any surprises?
Oh, lots of surprises. Little narrow roads, very narrow bridges, rain on forward crossings when the rain came up at the back of Bathurst, but very, very interesting.
How tough was the course?
Well, the course was pretty tough when we ran out through the mountains from Singleton through to Bathurst. It was along the Putty Road. It was very, very bumpy in some spots, but it was wonderful driving, fantastic driving.
Did you pack any surprises for the drivers in?
Oh, there were lots of surprises. There were lots of funny little corners that were not well marked on the maps, but they had to be pretty smart to find them. And working out in the middle of nowhere, it was good fun. A lot of people came in the wrong way. It was good fun.
...300 happy people meet at the Oasis Resort at Wollongong for a great dinner and the presentation. Masatoshi and Shimazaki received a special trophy, the furthest travelled entrance. John Robinson and John Mooney in the Mark V Jag, the drophead, best dressed in the rally. John Thompson from Shell, a special award. And now, the big moment. Can Ian Hancock do it after leading the rally for such a long time? Any one of six cars could be in the lead. And now, rally director Doug Henderson with the news.
Third place outright in the inaugural Repco Mountain Rally is car 94, Ian Hancock and Stephen McCullum.
The future for the Repco Mountain Rally. Perhaps the words of competitor and chief executive of Repco, Tony Smeaton, say it all.
I think we're now on the verge of some very special future event that's going to go on for a long time in the United States.